All right, so five new rice papers today from Kat Kerr. I'm just going to kind of hold them up there. You're not going to see them really well, but I'll show you each of them in the video as we go along right at the beginning. Girl power, that's what she's named this group, and it really is very positive affirmations about being a girl, whether you're an older girl or a younger girl. Either way, it's good stuff. So before I forget, up in the top, we're going to put Kat's video live on our YouTube channel at the same time, and there'll be a link up there to that. And then down below will be links to all of the products that I use today, and obviously to the rice papers themselves. We'll have them as a set of five as well as an open stock. So these are fun images that you can use in a variety of ways. This was meant to be a card front, but if you look up here, there's a spot right there where I think she's going to go on my wall, which is kind of my backdrop when I film these introductions. You do not, in any way, shape, or form, have to create realistic colors when you play with yours. I love this one. I think it's great. You can combine them. This is an art by Marlene Bird on a background that I did a while ago with one of the pieces from the Little Bird set, paper rather. And here are some more. And again, you'll see all of this in the video. Cards, journal pages, you can take pieces of these and make ATCs. There's a whole variety of ways that you can use them. Kat's done some wonderful things, and again, you'll see that in that video. She's going to show you how you can actually put papers down or pieces down and paint around them, which is not my approach, but it is definitely one that you should consider because I think it works really well. So let's go have some fun with these papers. The five rice papers are kind of a new look for Kat, and I really am thrilled with the designs. I liked them from the moment she showed them to me, and my mind really started taking over with some ideas for using them. So five sheets. Each of them has a color version of the imagery, and then there's a black and white version, and there's some text on here as well. So let me show them to you one at a time. This one is named Art Sister. This one is named Be in Awe. And then we have Little Bird. This one is Unfolding. And then this last one is You Are. So five different designs, all within this thematic girl power look, and again, black and white and color versions. Rice paper can be torn. You can tear it wet, you can tear it dry, or you can cut it with scissors, and I've actually done both. So tearing with scissors, I'm pretty sure I don't need to demo for you, but when you talk about wet tearing, and dry tearing is pretty straightforward. It's just going to be, you know, tearing it along your fingers, however you make that work, and you get this kind of a feathery edge that I always really like. But wet tearing produces a little bit more feathery edge. So I take a brush, and I just put some plain water on it, and I run the brush to make a wet line about where I know I want to tear. Now you can certainly refine this, and I'm only going to tear part of this. You don't need to see me tear the whole darn thing because the process is the same. But obviously, when this is wet, it softens the fibers and it makes it a little bit easier to separate. I'm always going to do the same thing that you just saw me do. I'm going to use my thumb and my thumbs on both hands with my fingers, and I'm going to just pinch and gently separate the fibers. Now, this is mulberry paper, and you can see that there are some heavier fibers in some places. Those might take a little bit more of a tug to go ahead and get them to separate, but I promise you that they will. And if you're careful and you're patient, you can pretty much get this to do anything that you need when it comes to tearing. And really, that's it. And you can see that again, the feathering is much more pronounced when you wet tear, and I like that look. So it's really up to you. If you don't want any, then you just go ahead and you cut with scissors. All right, let's get some paper towel just to pick up this water. So rice paper is translucent to begin with. I mean, you can see that here. This is pretty translucent. But with that said, there's more than one way to adhere it. And so when you use something like gel medium, so you can see already that this is reasonably transparent. You can see the darker color, and it's obvious, more obvious with darker colors than it would be with light. But when you use gel medium or another kind of wet adhesive, you're going to enhance the transparency of the paper. So depending on what look you're trying to achieve, and I'm going to do this kind of right over the center of the color here so that you can see what happens. depending on what color, what effect rather, you're trying to achieve, you may not want that transparency, or it may be exactly what you have in mind. So, where's my brush? This is the Filbert, the Princeton Filbert number 8 short-handled bristle brush that Elizabeth uses as a glue brush, and I have found that it works great, so I'm using it too. So I'm just going to come along here and I'm going to put a generous coat of gel medium, and then I'm going to lay these girls on here, and then I'm going to put gel medium over the top. And it's pretty obvious that the color underneath certainly is going to affect what you see on top. Now I'm not going to spend too much time here because this is just for test purposes so that you can see, but you need to think about what color you're putting your piece on when, if you're using gel medium. All right, let me stick this in some water and wipe this up. So for example, let's put this over here because we don't need to see that at the moment. When I want to avoid transparency, I'll use sticky stuff. So it's a thin sheet of adhesive that's sticky on both sides, and that's what I did here. And I took the piece, so we'll just pretend that this is the piece. I took the piece and I mounted it on a piece of white cardstock that already had sticky stuff on it. And now, and you can see here, this one has already been adhered. This background is dark enough that if I had just put, even though this is colored, if I had just put this on here with gel medium, I'm liable to have seen some of the color on the background coming through. So the simple solution is to just go ahead and mount it with sticky stuff or another dry adhesive on a piece of white cardstock and you won't get that effect. And then I like, this is a bird, these two pieces are from one of the earlier Art by Marlene die cut blocks. I like these a lot, and I'm sure Marlene doesn't mind, and I know that Kat doesn't mind if you mix and match your stuff, and I thought that this fit in particularly well, so I just need to come back and glue this. I might do a little bit of around the border, and then that page spread is essentially done. When I created this card, and this is one of our 5x7 index cards, I cut this piece out. So if you look, we're just going to pretend this is an index card. If I place this on here, you can see that if I line the bottom of her shirt up with the bottom of the card, I was going to get some of the stuff from the rest of the rice paper sheet on here, some of the other designs. Now if I align this like this, obviously that cuts this off here, but I still have these pieces. So my solution to that, you can't really see it because of the way that this blends, I cut the rice paper right along the top profile of her hair. I glued it on this index card, and for this one, because it didn't matter about the transparency, I just went ahead and I used gel medium. This up here is just me approximating the stars and some other stuff. Now, the dots and the stickles were not part of the original design, but again, Kat's not going to care if you change this up and make it fit your aesthetic and how you work. So that's really easy to do. And then when I'm ready, this is just a card front or a card base. All I have to do is mount this on here, and I would probably use sticky stuff for that. And then I have a card that just needs a sentiment and it's ready to go. Now something to keep in mind, this is an A7 card, so it's 5x7. If you want to work a little bit smaller, you could take this design and you could chop it in a way that works for whatever you're doing. If you're working on a smaller card, you can bring this down. You could also make this a little bit smaller and stack it on layers. So if this were smaller and I had some other layers underneath, I could stack this and create more of a frame-like effect. So there's lots of different ways that you can work with these images. Don't limit yourself to any size or any shape. In fact, if you want to cut these girls apart, you absolutely can do that. If you want to trim this piece out, however you want to use these, I think you should let your imagination run wild and just do whatever it is that works. So when you have these black and white versions, you can use them as is, and they're beautiful just the way they are, or you can add color. And coming up next, I'm going to show you how I add color to these, and you can use things like ink sprays, you can use paint. Now, ink sprays are going to be transparent, so you can add color on here. Paint is a little bit different because paint has varying opacities, and there are some things to take into consideration, and that's what I'm going to talk about next. depending on the effect you want, the first question you probably need to ask yourself is whether you're going to work on wet or dry. Now, if you work on something that's wet, if I've added water to this, there's going to be lots of color movement and lots of wicking. If I don't, then it's going to be a little bit more controlled. Now, I'm going to demo this with one of Tim's Distress spray stains. These are transparent and it matters to what you're doing. So for example, if I pick this color up and I just come ahead and I go ahead and I apply it here, you can see that there's a little bit of bleeding that goes on. But conversely, now this has got a little bit of color in it, but conversely, if I wet this first and then I come back, I'm going to need a little bit more color. If I come back with some color, you're going to see that the wicking is going to be far more pronounced. It's pretty much going to travel and follow the water. So you can see what happens. I've already got some blooming that goes on, and it just will continue to creep until the color's kind of bled out as much as it can. So when you work like this, for me the first question is what am I trying to achieve? Do I want to blend like this with wicking, or do I want more contained color? And that really depends on the effect you're trying to achieve and what you have in mind. So with that said, I've got color here, and one of the first things that I can tell you is I make certain, or I try to remember to make certain, that the area I'm working on is clean. Let me just grab a piece of paper towel. Because if this were dry and I put something wet over the top of it, this is Distress spray stain and it is going to reactivate. It's going to come right up through the back of that paper, and that may not be the look I was trying for. So I want to make certain that my surface is clean. So I've already put kind of Caucasian flesh color on this face. And you can see that it's pretty well contained, but here in the eye, if I turn this toward you, see how this color that bled into the eye, into the white of her eye, and even into the iris, there's a way to fix that. So you need to do it, obviously, when everything is dry. And I'm gonna do this a little bit out of order just because I want you to see. But the way that I can remedy this is by, this is a Posca paint pen. This is a PC1MR. So it's the tip that's pretty darn fine. And I can come in and I can go over the white of her eye and fix this so that it doesn't look like she's got some kind of a bloodshot eye thing going on. Now, with that said, the thing you don't want to do, whether you're using a brush or one of these in any tip size, is you don't want to repeatedly move on the same spot. You will eventually pill the paper. This is only 30 GSM, and not only will you pill it, but if you push hard enough, you're going to poke right through it. So if I need to come back and add a little bit more, I can do that. Now, I will tell you that Poscas actually work better in terms of not sinking into the fiber if you apply a coat of gel medium first. But I don't want to do that here because I'm not ready for that to kind of be the final step. I want to come in and add some color, and I know that there's going to be a little bit of color movement. So I used, this is the PC1MR, this is the metallic green color. So she's got a kind of shiny iris here. But I'm going to come in and fill this in, because who says that this has to be realistic? She just needs to look in a way that makes me happy. So now her eye is really all set, and I fixed that kind of smudge that was there before. So let's talk now about the hair. And for this, I'm just picking a couple of colors of the Amsterdam acrylic paint. I want her hair to be brown with kind of some red highlights in it. So I'm going to put some brown out. Now I'm probably not going to do her whole head, well, you know what, I am going to do her whole head of hair. Because if you don't, what I have discovered is, if you're working on an area, you need to finish it before the paint dries. Coming back, once it's dry, the paint is never going to blend in the same way that it did previously. So let's put some of these colors out, and then I'm just going to get some movement going on and some color in her hair. Now again, I'm going to work dry because I don't want there to be too much color movement, color wicking. There's already a lot of detail in her hair. All I want to do, I am going to put some water down. All I want to do is stroke some color in her hair and make it look kind of like hair. Now I'm going to blend these two colors together, and then I probably will come back and I'll probably use some of that reddish color to add some on top. So again, because there's very little water here, I don't have a lot of movement, which is fine because that's what I'm trying to control. So if I come in here, I can stroke some of that red in and give her a bit of a different look there. And I don't have nearly enough paint out here, but that's all right. We'll come back to that in 1 second. I'll put some more out. So you have options, and I'm going to show you an example in a minute where the colors are nothing like you would expect. In fact, they are not humanoid colors at all, but I really like the way that it looks, so for me that works. Let's put down some more of this color. And if I come in here while this is wet, I can stroke on some color and get a little bit of blending that's going on, and I like the way that that looks. So then I'm just going to grab some more of the brown. Now, when you work with paint, you're talking about various transparencies or opacities, and this brown is reasonably opaque, which means it's going to camouflage a lot of the lines and detail that are in her hair. Now, you can come back. If you haven't, you can use this as a guide. You've got that one already. You can come back and you can add some more detail, and I've got another one that I can show you that's already dry. You have to wait till it's dry, but you absolutely can do it. All right, I'm not going to spend a lot of time here because, you know, you don't need to see me paint this whole thing ad infinitum or ad nauseum. Whoops, that was her ear, but that's all right. We're just going to cover her ear with paint and make it look like her hair is covering her ear. I won't tell if you don't. All right, I'm pretty darn satisfied with this at this point. So for something like her skin, I actually watered down. I didn't use a lot of water when I was painting, but I did thin down the colors so that I got more transparency and less coverage. That's something that you'll want to think about when you work. And one of the things that I also did was I blended in some of the Distress spray stains to create a color that felt more like Caucasian skin, but again, was transparent enough that I wasn't really obliterating everything underneath it. So this is good to go at this point. I'm not going to really do any more. I'm just going to put her to one side. Now the thing that I need to do is clean up underneath here, because the next sheet I set down will pick up those colors if I don't. All right, so let's move her to one side. Okay, so here's my girl that is nothing like humanoid colors, and I think she's great. She's fun. I like the way that she looks. So one of the first things that you'll notice is that, or one of the first things that I see, is that on this side, the paint has actually covered a fair amount of the detail in her hair. Now the music notes and the music in the background, I'm not going to try to fix that, but what I can do, again with a black PC1MR, I can come in and I can pretty much do this any place where the color of the paint might have added too much opacity over the black, so I can't really see what I wanted to here. This does get a little bit warped when you add water, so I'm using these two fingers to kind of hold this down flat, and I can see enough of this to just come through and go ahead and add that line back in. And I know that there's a bow here. This is a little bit thicker line, so I want to get that in. And then there's the other part of the bow here. So this is actually quite easy to do. And this stuff is pretty forgiving. I mean, other than putting color where you don't mean to, sometimes you can kind of blot it out, sometimes you can't. But, you know, it's live and learn. If I need to come in and I think I need to fix anything around her eyes, which at this point I don't, I'm going to leave them alone, I can do that. So, again, there's nothing realistic about her in terms of the colors, but I think that this is a fun way to play. So cards and journal pages, there's just almost an unlimited number of ways that you can use this. I didn't get to show you this in the last segment, but again, this is just a piece of that little bird paper that I combined with another bird from one of Marlene's die-cut blocks. So you've got stuff at home already that you can coordinate with these, whether you're using them on a card or you're using them on a journal page, whether you're wet tearing or dry tearing. These are Kat Kerr's new Girl Power rice papers, and they're in stock and shipping now at joggles.com.